During that time, the brand has grown from an extremely affordable, really a cheap car for the mass market. They've expanded their lineup to include a fleet of good cars offered at a great value, but now they're looking to push further and they want to push your perceptions of what a luxury car actually is. This is that vehicle. This is the 2015 Kia K900, and it's ready to take aim at some serious competition. If Kia is going to build a luxury car, they're going to need a car that looks luxurious. And thankfully, the Kia K900 does just that. Up front, it has a stylized version of the signature grille. Here, we come to these very cool looking headlights with a bunch of individual LED headlamp elements, and these turn into the corners at night when you're driving to illuminate the corner. You've got some cool daytime running lights as well that are also up here. Around to the side, you've got 19-inch wheels front and rear, and they're a staggered setup. The shoulder is great. It's got a really strong shoulder line. Out back, it actually looks like a blend of a BMW, and you'll see a few other elements in there, but it works on this car and helps present that luxurious look. It's hard to sell a luxury car to luxury car buyers if you don't have a potent power plant under the hood, and we've got a good one here under the hood of the K900. This, if you're a fan of Hyundai, will be a familiar engine. This is the Tao 5-liter V8 GDI motor. GDI means it has gasoline direct injection. This one pushes out 429 horsepower. It sends it through an 8-speed automatic gearbox and on out to the rear wheels. This is a proper luxury sedan setup, and it shows that Kia is paying attention to how a luxury sedan should be built. The real question though is, what's it like on the inside? So you can't be just an engine and rear-wheel drive and some good looks on the outside. To really get luxury car buyers, you're also gonna have to have a car that's luxurious on the inside. And Kia has tried really hard in this regard. They searched for a long time to get the right Napa leather, and these seats are incredibly comfortable. The rear seats, because this car is fitted with the VIP package, have winged headrests, they recline, they're heated and cooled. There's a whole lot going on back there that lend the true luxury that you would want to find in a car at this price point. From up here in the front though, there are other things to like. All the touch points feel great. The leather and wood on the steering wheel looks fantastic. The soft touch over here on the door sills and right here in front of the passenger, and the way this dash is laid out really give this a luxury car feel. And that's really important because to get the buyers that might be looking at a BMW or a Mercedes or an Audi or a Lexus are gonna want that. And when they get in this car, they're gonna get it, but they're gonna get more than that because they're getting a level of technology that might not be readily available at this price point for the big boys. Kia says that the buyer of the K900 is looking for style, technology, luxury, and value. And they get it. Kia is nailing all those points. But I'm also concerned with, besides those, because they've already got tech done with the Yuvo E services, the great looking navigation screen, the really cool TFT screen with the digital gauges that you can change to a sport driving mode. It's pretty cool tech, but it doesn't matter if the car doesn't drive well. Yes, it's got 429 horsepower, but how does it put that to good use? That's a pretty good way to put it to good use. You've got the 8-speed gearbox, which is surprisingly smooth, though I guess if you have that many gears, you expect a transmission like that to be smooth. And this is no exception. It works pretty well. You can change the drive mode to a sportier drive mode where it will hold the gears longer. And it's pretty nice. It's nothing crazy. It feels like the throttle mapping is also slightly altered, so it's a little bit more responsive, but this is not a sports car. And Kia isn't trying to claim that it's a luxury sports car. They've really centered on the luxury and the tech to produce a driving experience that they're trying to use to rival that of the rivals, the Germans and the Japanese. And they've done a really good job. The only area in terms of the driving experience where I feel it falls a little flat is in the steering feel, because there's none of it. It is better than Kia products of past, where it was this artificial rubberiness, even if you pressed a button and dialed in a little more sport. That's gone, but so is any feel. You can hustle this car a little bit, but you're gonna have to get used to it first. It's fun that it has rear wheel drive. It's a lot of fun that it has rear wheel drive and all that power, but when you're in a corner, you don't really know what the front wheels are doing. So if they could dial back in a little bit of feel, that would go a long way. But here we are, the car is not trying to be sporty, it's trying to be luxurious, and it does that rather well. The road noise is non-existent. Somehow Kia was able to even eliminate the wind noise you get off the mirrors. This car is quiet, and that is fantastic. It's a place you can retreat to and enjoy some solitude on your drive home. It's comfortable, the suspension is fantastic. It didn't use the air system that the Equus, its Korean kissing cousin, used. Instead, it's got a multi-link suspension up front and in the back. It's got 4-piston front brakes. It's got 19-inch staggered wheels and tires. So it's got a really excellent ride, and that's something that a luxury buyer is most certainly gonna check off the list. So has Kia done enough to attract the likes of the luxury car buyer? It's a tough call, because some of them are motivated simply by the brand, but there's a reason for that. It's an aspirational goal to work hard in life, earn a good living, and then reward yourself with a nice car. You can do that, and it's something lovely. It's gotta be a great feeling, I imagine, because I haven't done it, but you go to the dealership, you sign the papers, and you put that BMW 3-star in your garage. You put the 4 rings of an Audi in your garage. You put even, say, an Acura or something premium to luxury, like an Infiniti as well, in your garage. You've worked hard, you've earned that car. Are buyers going to now go, man, I've been busting my butt for years, here we go, it's time to make the purchase that makes me happy, and it's a Kia? I hope so, because what they'll be doing is rewarding themselves smartly. They'll be rewarding themselves with a vehicle that is worth the money. It's worth the $65,000, like this car, which is fitted with the V8 VIP package, which is basically all that rear seat goodiness right there. Because even though it's a Kia, you're working with a brand that has come a long way. Residual value scores are way up. Initial quality scores are way up. Brand perception is way up. And if this car helps push brand perception higher, it will be doing its job. I don't expect them to sell many, many thousands of these. I expect them to sell quite a few hundred of these per month. And that's all you really want with a car like this. Raise brand awareness, make some people happy, and change perception. So what we have here is a $65,000 proposition that you've taken a chance and changed your perception of luxury. Let's remove the badges for a minute and let's look at the stats of the car. 430 horsepower, 429 to be exact, rear wheel drive, Napa leather, tons of options, exceedingly quiet on the road. This is a comfortable cruiser that does battle with extremely expensive offerings from Japan and Germany. Your perception has to have changed of what a luxury car can be to accept that this is worth that price. But maybe you should open your mind and take a chance if you're in that market, because what you're gonna find is luxurious